This is 10's late news with all the news you need this Tuesday. Tonight, in developing news, a child attacked while carried by her mother in the middle of a Perth shopping centre. An Aussie goodbye for the King and Queen. Sunshine and a barbecue with thousands turning out to see them. New tonight, Antony Blinken arrives in the Middle East as Tel Aviv is placed under a state of emergency. The big supermarkets accused of making dodgy discounts, and now the ACCC is taking them to court. A pilot killed in a plane crash west of Melbourne. Why Aussie mining giant BHP is being sued for billions of dollars. We break down the leaked plan by Israel to attack Iran. The painting expected to rake in hundreds of thousands of dollars, but it was made by a robot. Why the creators of Blade Runner are suing Elon Musk. And the poor woman who just wanted to get her phone back.
Welcome to 10's Late News with Ursula Hayden.
Good evening. In developing news, police have issued an urgent alert tonight after a toddler was attacked inside a Perth shopping centre. The little girl was being held by her mother when a stranger ran up and assaulted her. Jess Hayes has the details.
Ursula, police released this security camera vision, which shows a two-year-old girl being struck in her mother's arms. It happened around 1:30 local time this afternoon at a shopping centre in East Victoria Park. Police say the toddler's face was injured during the attack. They also believe the woman was a stranger to her victims, and the assault appears to have come out of the blue. Officers say the woman took off after the attack. Police are now investigating as they try to piece together why it happened.
Royal superfans raced into position at the Opera House this afternoon for a final brush with Their Majesties King Charles and Queen Camilla. The final day had sovereigns turning sausages, the King given an Akubra, and a royal flyover on the Harbour City.
As the sun set on the sovereign's visit, excitement levels were peaking.
I kissed the hand of the King and I'm very happy, and I told to the King, I love you to death.
And then Queen Camilla just looked so beautiful in her white dress. And, oh God, that was just so cool.
A Mexican wave for their Australian farewell. It followed a sizzling day in Western Sydney, where Their Majesties had a go on the tools.
Look at that. What is better than an Aussie barbecue than served up by the King and Queen and overseen by the world's best surf lifesavers? I mean, what a moment.
The royals were presented with a taste of New South Wales. Anzac bickies and wattle seed shortbread on offer, and the aprons out.
Shown in the way that we prefer it, with the jam underneath and the cream on top. I'm not sure how he likes his.
The invitation-only event,
excited and shocked that I am here,
had a touch of Wiggles magic sans the skivvies.
Oh, I feel honoured to be here, and great. There's such a good feeling here. People, you know, we're Westies. I was born at Leyland Park, and Johnny's a ride boy.
Yesterday's interruption from independent Indigenous Senator Lydia Thorpe made international headlines.
You are not a king!
Another small anti-monarch demonstration today. But the King was warmly welcomed to the National Centre for Indigenous Excellence, where His Majesty accepted the offer of a rare tight squeeze and received this greeting from a Wiradjuri woman.
Yeah, I'm Stolen Generation Kirumundra, but I won't have, I'll give you a shake. Okay, oh, welcome to this country.
While the royals have maintained energy and high spirits throughout their tour, the pace of their itinerary has been demanding. Hard hats, handshakes, charity luncheons and boat rides. It's easy to forget the 75-year-old sovereign is receiving cancer treatment, meeting patients at the Melanoma Institute personal.
And the treatment isn't too bad, is it? Because the immunotherapy, There was minimal side effects. So
exactly.
Learning about clinical trials.
We want to put everybody out of the job here.
And melanoma prevention.
Slip, slop, slap, seek and slide.
The King's slides were back on as he and Queen Camilla walked the Opera House steps, just as the younger royals have during their time in Australia over the last decade. The question now is how the monarch's visit will shift public opinion, forging stronger ties to the Commonwealth or strengthening the Republican movement. For some citizens, the visit ignited patriotism, offered reflections on reconciliation, and showcased the nation's best in science, service, and community. If anything, it was historic. Sarah Navin for 10 News First.
The final few hours of the King and Queen's royal visit will be for private engagements. They fly to Samoa tomorrow for the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting, also known as CHOGM. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese will also be in attendance. There has been growing pressure for the discussion of reparations for Commonwealth countries affected by slavery and colonialism, but the UK Prime Minister has ruled that out from being on the agenda. It is a complicated issue that awaits the King on the Pacific Island.
Thank you, Samara. In developing news tonight, Hezbollah is claiming to have bombed Israel's military intelligence unit after 20 missiles have reportedly targeted the headquarters of the 8200 unit, which was responsible for the pager attacks, as well as a naval base in the city of Haifa. A state of emergency has been declared in Tel Aviv as US Secretary of State Antony Blinken touched down for ceasefire talks. Israel is continuing its strikes on Gaza and northern Lebanon, where 24 people have been killed. Leaked top secret documents have apparently revealed how Israel is preparing its retaliatory attack on Iran over its missile barrage earlier this month. The documents leaked last week on the messaging app Telegram appear to show an American official's assessment of Israel's plans. It includes that the Israeli Air Force will use long-range ballistic missiles, avoiding the need to enter the airspace of neighbouring countries such as Jordan. There is no mention of what they are targeting or when we can expect these strikes to occur. The documents also reveal Israel is not planning to activate its nuclear deterrent, putting Washington in an uncomfortable situation given their refusal to outwardly acknowledge that Israel even has nuclear weapons. Investigations into how these documents were leaked are underway, with White House officials calling the security breach deeply concerning. Our supermarket giants are being accused of gouging customers with dodgy discounts in almost every aisle. That's according to a new filing by the consumer watchdog in the federal court, which revealed 500 everyday products were inflated, then dropped to claim prices were down.
Spanning across almost every aisle, we now know the extent of the consumer watchdog's allegations against both Coles and Woolworths. 10 News First has obtained documents lodged with the federal court alleging customers were misled by specials that were more expensive than the regular price as much as 2 years earlier. Topping the list for Woolworths, Raid Day and Night Fly and Mozzie Protection, the price spiking from $9 to $13.50 for 6 weeks, then put on special for $12.50, 39% higher than the regular price. At Coles, Dettol hand wash refill went from $7 to $10.50 for a month and discounted to $9.50, 36% up. The first case management hearing is tomorrow, and separate to this, there are now also two class action lawsuits in the works against Coles and Woolies.
We want to get some money back into the pockets of Australian consumers who've been misled. It could be between $2,000 and $5,000.
Carter Kuppner Law Firm says it's been inundated by outraged shoppers, 4,000 people registering in under a week.
With Queenslanders heading to the polls in just 3 days, the Premier and opposition leader faced off tonight in a fiery debate. The Brisbane Olympics, 50 cent public transport and koala conservation were all debated, but the most heated moment was reserved for abortion policy.
It's one message that I want to give to every single Queenslander today. There'll be no changes to abortion law.
This is a really important issue.
I think it shouldn't change.
Everyone knows.
I think it shouldn't change. The law should remain the same.
Will you have a conscience vote?
The laws will remain the same.
What is your view?
There will be no change.
The question was the result of Qatar Australian Party leader Robbie Katter announcing that he will introduce a private members' bill to repeal abortion laws. A pilot has died after crashing his light plane just outside of an airfield west of Melbourne this morning. The man in his 20s was the sole occupant and is yet to be identified. Sophie Jacobson has the details.
Well, it was just before 11:30 a.m. this morning when police believe that the pilot lost control of his aircraft and crash-landed into the paddock behind me. It's unclear exactly what caused the crash, but it's believed he lost control. He was the sole occupant of the aircraft and died at the scene. The Australian Transport Safety Bureau has commenced an investigation here. It says shortly after takeoff from Bacchus Marsh Airport, the aircraft descended and collided with terrain in a paddock right next to the airport. Investigators have been here all day conducting a range of activities, including a wreckage examination, also site mapping with a drone. They're also looking to speak to anyone who may have witnessed this deadly crash.
All of a sudden we just heard a big bang, and it wasn't until we seen the emergency services and the flashing lights and the ambulance helicopter arrive that we knew something bad had gone on.
It's believed police, firefighters, ambulance and SES crews will be on the scene late into this evening as they piece together what exactly went wrong to cause this fatal accident.
A 49-year-old man is being mourned tonight, allegedly hit and killed by a disqualified driver in Sydney's West. Police say the 43-year-old male learner had taken off after being spotted acting suspiciously by a patrol car.
This is a tragedy beyond belief. You have an innocent 49-year-old male going to work, and he doesn't go to work and he doesn't go home. His family don't get to see him.
Police are now investigating their own actions in the lead up to the crash. The teenager that struck and killed the South Australian Police Commissioner's son in a schoolie's hit and run has been spared jail. The police commissioner has spoken, saying it doesn't get any easier.
Late to his own sentencing, Diren Randhawa rushes into the district court, his mother by his side, unknowing if her teenage son would be leaving with her.
Are you worried about going to jail today?
At just 19 years old, Randhawa pleaded guilty to aggravated driving without due care and leaving the scene of a crash after causing Charlie Stevens' death at schoolies celebrations in November last year.
Each court date that's come up has been difficult, stressful and emotional for our family. We're grateful that Diren chose to plead guilty to this offence because that brought this part of it to a conclusion much more quickly.
The court today hearing 18-year-old Charlie was standing on the road with his friends in Goolwa when they asked Randhawa for a ride. Their request denied because the young driver didn't have his full licence. And although Randhawa wasn't speeding when he approached the group a second time, he did accelerate, swerving right to avoid the group of men but hitting Charlie, who he hadn't seen, and driving off. He then turned himself into police shortly after on his mum's advice. To their relief, Randhawa was spared custody and with it risk of deportation to Malaysia, instead receiving a 13-month suspended sentence. Judge Tracy handed the teenager a 2-year good behaviour bond and disqualified him from driving for a decade.
Was that the outcome you were expecting?
The end of the court process, but a lifetime of heartache for the Stevens family.
It's not that we now move on. We're learning to live life without Charlie. And we're just always reminded of his absence.
Brianna Boylan for 10 News First.
A New South Wales woman attempting to retrieve her dropped phone has spent hours dangling by just her feet, wedged inside a rock crevice. These pictures were taken by the paramedics after the woman's friends called for help. Apparently, she had slipped between two boulders which had to be removed. Once they were, the woman was then brought out through a tight S-bend over the course of an hour. In total, it took 7 hours to free the woman, but her phone was never retrieved. Well, stay with us up next. The shocking news about disgraced Hollywood mogul Harvey Weinstein. Why the size of your brain could lead to future health issues. And later, the university that's offering a degree in being an influencer. Welcome back. It's the largest class action in English history, and at the centre of it, Australian company BHP is being accused of cynically and doggedly trying to avoid responsibility. In 2015, a dam holding toxic waste from an iron ore mine in southeastern Brazil breached, with the torrent wiping out a nearby community in minutes. 19 people, including a 5-year-old child, died, and much of the community was destroyed. BHP was a joint shareholder in the company running the mine and, with its partners, provided compensation as well as mitigating environmental damage. But lawyers for a class action suit by over 600,000 people and 46 local governments say the compensation paid had profound shortcomings. Instead, they're seeking £36 billion, or close to $70 billion Australian dollars.
We start having a little hope that the company will be held accountable and pay us what they owe us. Although whatever money they pay us, they will still owe us.
For its part, BHP denies it is liable, saying the company had limited knowledge of the dam and no knowledge that its stability was compromised. The trial will take 12 weeks. Donald Trump is being sued for defamation by the so-called Central Park Five, black and Hispanic men wrongfully convicted for the 1989 rape of a jogger in a park. It came out, the comments came during Trump's September presidential debate, in which he said the men had killed a person and admitted guilt. The group are seeking damages, saying Trump intentionally caused distress and pointing out not one of the victims of the Central Park rapes were killed. Harvey Weinstein has been reportedly diagnosed with bone marrow cancer a month after he was indicted on a new sex crime charge. NBC News says the disgraced Hollywood mogul is undergoing treatment at Rikers Island Prison in New York. Weinstein also recently underwent an emergency procedure to remove fluid from his heart and lungs. Having a big brain is said to make you more intelligent, but new research has found it could also put you at risk of Parkinson's. Scientists in Brisbane believe brain size could be linked to degenerative disorders and even ADHD.
Holding scissors, walking or riding a bike are challenging for Sandy Gershwitz. After 2 years of pain and struggling, she was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease aged 45.
So many different things that happen in life that you take for granted and you don't realise, simple things of life, how hard they can become.
More than 150,000 Australians are living with Parkinson's and there is no known cure. But research by QIMR Berghofer could be the key to future treatment.
We were able to find 254 genetic variants associated with differences in size of subcortical volumes, 161 of which were new.
Scientists found genetic variants which form the brain's structure and size also influence the risk of neurodegenerative or neurodevelopmental disorders. Larger volumes in key regions of the brain is linked with Parkinson's disease, while smaller sizes are linked to ADHD.
So the next steps would be to understand how genetics influences brain function and how brain function, which is influenced by genetics, is related to different brain functions in health and in disease.
Tiani Reid for 10 News First.
An AI robot is said to make history as the first to sell a painting at auction. The dark, haunting portrait of English mathematician Alan Turing will go under the hammer next month in London. The artist, a humanoid robot powered by AI, is called Ada. It has cameras in its eyes as well as bionic hands. The painting is expected to fetch up to $300,000. Is that how the robots see us? Well, up next this Tuesday, an important development for a New South Wales town in a state of emergency. And watch this man's narrow escape from death. Welcome back. A backup electricity generator is slowly restoring power in Broken Hill almost a week after severe storms caused mass outages. Six towers were taken out by the wild weather last Wednesday. A backup generator was brought in, but it failed on Monday. A natural disaster declaration has been made for the region.
And I want to assure the community that everything is being done from the New South Wales government as well as electricity and utility providers to get the lights back on and to get services back on track.
Supplies have been trucked in and the Premier has promised more financial help will follow. At least six people have been killed in Cuba by the second landing of a now ex-hurricane. The island nation had already been dealing with widespread blackouts. Josh Holt has more.
Good evening. The lights are back on in parts of Cuba, but the cleanup is only just beginning. Ex-Hurricane Oscar made landfall on the island nation again, but as a tropical storm this time. It triggered flash floods and unfortunately killed several people. While power is back on in the capital, Havana, many people outside the city are still struggling with the constant blackouts. Let's have a look at the national forecast as we get through Wednesday. Partly cloudy skies to Brisbane at 29. You will notice through the eastern part of Australia, it is starting to warm up tomorrow. Sydney, 27 degrees, partly cloudy. Canberra, a top of 25. A shower or two for Melbourne and 21. Sunny skies for Adelaide, hitting the same mark tomorrow. Could see some showers in Hobart as well, 19 degrees. Sunny skies for Perth and 24. Sunny for Alice Springs and 37. And we're looking at a shower or two for Darwin with 34 degrees. So some light showers in the southern part of the continent and the east looking very hot as we get through Wednesday.
Thanks, Josh. A man has been forced to run for his life to avoid being crushed by a truck in Brazil. Shocking video captured the man bolting as the truck came barreling towards him. The vehicle tipped onto its side just seconds after he made it to safety. Elon Musk and Tesla are being sued by the maker of Blade Runner 2049, who allege Musk used imagery from the movie without permission. Alcon Entertainment claims it specifically refused a request from Warner Brothers to use the material for the launch of Musk's much-anticipated robo-taxi. Alcon went a step further, accusing event organisers of false endorsement. Musk has referred to Blade Runner multiple times at his recent events, suggesting that the film served as inspiration for Tesla's Cybertruck. Well, if you're still trying to get your head around what it is to be a social media influencer or how to be one, well, now an Irish university has you covered. The four-year course has been introduced at the Southeast Technical University at Carlo, teaching students how to make money from their social media platforms. The first cohort of students will learn subjects including celebrity studies, entrepreneurship, storytelling, psychology, and podcasting. Not sure it needs a degree. Well, that's all the news you need this Tuesday. I'm Ursula Hager. Thank you so much for joining us on 10's Late News. We hope you have a great night.